he took a science professor, fed him lots of sugar, strapped him onto a roller coaster, and then scanned his brain, it would probably resemble that of my next guest. He has captained us through wormholes, made us travel back in time, saved Gotham City, and after each adventure, we are stuck staring at our phone, trying to Google the science behind what we've just witnessed. He doesn't allow chairs on his set, but has been gracious enough to sit in one and answer all my questions about his latest mind-boggler, Tenet. It's so lovely to meet you.
Well, thank you.
You took a picture with my cousin when you came to Mumbai, and he posted us the caption that said, "I'm so excited to meet Christopher Nolan. My nipples are standing." And they really were through his t-shirt. I think the rest of India is equally excited about Tenet. And I saw it. It was magnificent. It was baffling. How did you come up with this concept?
The culmination of some ideas about exploring ideas of time and science fiction that I've had for quite some time. The idea of a bullet being sucked out of a wall and back into the barrel of a gun. That's something I actually put in my film Memento many years ago in a symbolic sense. But I always harbored a desire to create a world where the characters would have to deal with the physical reality of that. And I've always wanted to make a sort of globe-trotting spy film, you know, an espionage thriller. And so combining those two things was something I just got very excited about.
So you have Priya as an arms dealer from Mumbai. All of us wanted to know, how did you think of casting Dimple? Well, my mom. What was the one thing that convinced you that she was right for the part?
Sitting in the room with her and talking to Dimple, and the charisma and the poise that she has, and the depth of experience, which was immediately apparent when, you know, I turned up in Mumbai with my video camera and asked her to perform a couple of scenes, and we worked together and I tried things different way and asked her to do things different ways. Her skill and charisma was immediately apparent. It was very much what I wanted for that character. So I was very, very excited to have found someone who I knew could take what I had hoped for and what I'd put on the page and take it to the next level.
And she called me before she had to go for the audition, and she said, "I'm very, very stressed out. I have to go for this audition, and I don't know what to give Christopher Nolan as a gift." And I was like, "Mom, you're going for an audition, not his housewarming party. Just go and do your best." And when she came back and she told me what all she did in the audition, I was convinced she would never get the part. Apparently, she was recommending other actresses for her role. Is that true?
It is true. It's not the first time. I seem to remember meeting, I think it was Liam Neeson for a part in Batman Begins, and he immediately started recommending other actors and saying, no, you don't want me. You know? And I don't quite know what goes into that thinking on the part of a great actor. I don't know, but if anything, it makes you more excited to work with that person because you see a sense of modesty about them. You see a sense of nervousness in a way. And that's the kind of creative person that you want to collaborate with. It was a really, really fun audition, actually, for me. I mean, she said she was nervous. I think we flew all the way to Mumbai from Los Angeles just for that one audition and went all the way back the next day, or the same day, I think. And then we started filming in LA, and then we went to Estonia. I always kind of knew that there was going to be this exciting moment where Dimple would turn up in Tallinn in Estonia, and we'd get to work together.
For the longest time, a representation of an Indian was Appu in The Simpsons. So this was really fascinating to see, you know, this really modern, independent woman. Did you do a lot of research to find an Indian who was like that? Or how did that come about?
Well, I had the good fortune, I mean, I'd been to India before, I'd filmed in India very briefly on Dark Knight Rises in Jodhpur. But I had the good fortune to come to Mumbai seeing this incredible place, because I think the architecture of Mumbai, the scale of the place, the mixture of eras, it's extremely inspiring. A filmmaker, you want to grab your camera. But what I didn't want to do was use it as a backdrop. I wanted to really have a story connection, have a character who's from that world and of that world. And that's what Dimple and I were able to create together. And I think that's a very important part of the scope and the scale of the film, shooting in the streets and shooting up on the skyscraper and doing stunt work and all this stuff. One of the great movie industries of the world, and it was really fun to come in and be a part of it for a bit.
Have you seen any Bollywood movies?
Yeah, no, I have. I'm a fan. I think that Bollywood films, they have a sort of what we call sort of primal sensibilities. They've got broad strokes, they've got an operatic sensibility, not unlike what in Hollywood they've been doing with the superhero genre, for example. They're very big, broad movements of entertainment and music, sound, image, all coming together. I think some of the energy of Bollywood films is missing a little bit from what Hollywood is doing.
I mean, that's very gracious of you. I don't know if there's anything. And it is a palindrome, which means it's the same backwards and forwards, and you're doing that with time, which It's completely baffling. I was trying to explain that to my son, and my little one stood up and she said, I know a word like that. And unfortunately, that word turned out to be poop, which is also a palindrome. But
I can use that for the sequel, right?
But how did you explain the idea, the story to your actors? Did they get it? Because I saw some interviews where they said, we've seen it 5 times and we still don't understand the movie. So how did you really sit down and explain this to someone?
I think sometimes when the actors say this, I have a lot of experience with these kind of movies. The actors don't want to be held to account for all the complexities of the stories. It was there on the page for them in terms of the movements of the spy story of the film. Who's the good guy? Who are the bad guys? What's the action? What's the excitement? It was impossible to visualize. One of my senses of excitement around the subject matter is that time and the portrayal of time in this reverse way is entirely dependent on the movie camera. So this can only be a movie. The film camera shows us time in a way that wasn't possible before the invention of the movie camera. So it becomes the most cinematic of subjects, and you actually have to see the finished film to really know. You have to feel it rather than understand it. It's not something you can intellectualize or intuit.
No, there are group discussions after every movie. There are people adding their little bits and trying to piece it all together, which I think is part of almost every movie, the ambiguous bits and other people trying to fathom what that was all about. You don't allow chairs, cigarettes, and cell phones on your sets. Is that true?
Cigarettes and cell phones. There are plenty of chairs on my sets. I don't use my own chair. I tend to stay on my feet because what I learned over the years is if I sit down, my energy level drops, and it's hard to get back up. If, you know, they're playing the scene out of the corner of their eye, you know, you can see a crew member in the corner kind of with a little glow from the phone, you know, who's off in another world. So we try and enforce a level of concentration on you know, what's going on dramatically on the set. And I try to keep that as quiet and as focused as possible. So we don't ban people from talking because we can't do that. But we do ask everyone to be a little quiet, everyone to have a sense of reverence for what the actors are doing.
But you don't use a cell phone yourself, or so I believe.
In my work, I'm surrounded by phones and people with phones all the time. And so it's very easy to get in touch with me. I'm also easily distractible, and I don't want to be sitting there, you know, looking online when I should be focused on my work.
Yeah, I have a friend who doesn't use cell phones, and he says smartphones are for dumb people. And obviously, we're watching your movies, you're making them without these phones, and then we are Googling all of that on our smartphone. So I suppose you are on the right track. You are fascinated with time. You dilate it in dreams, you warp it with gravity, you reverse it with entropy. And we, I think, are running out of time. So I have one last question. If, like in Tenet, you could go back in time, what would you tell the young Christopher Nolan? The one thing he must never do and the one thing he must.
I think I'm more in line with Rob Pattinson's view of things in the film. The character of Neil says, what's happened's happened. And the policy is to suppress, policy is to not give information from the future to the past, because you don't know what the consequences would have been. So some of the mistakes I've made in the past, they may inadvertently have led me to a better place than I would have wound up in had I not made those mistakes. I would be very, very cautious about telling my younger self anything. In fact, I think I'd probably try to avoid myself.
Thank you very much for talking to me, and I hope all of India loves this movie as much as I do.
Thank you.